Good morning, everyone. It's a great pleasure to be here. I am delighted to take part in this event. You know, at Fortune, we are known for our coverage of the world's largest corporations. And as it happens, yesterday, Fortune released the Fortune Global 500 list for 2021. Some of you may have seen it. The companies on that list generated a total revenues of $32 trillion. That's equal to about a third of the world's GDP. The smallest company on our list reported a revenue of $24 billion. So very large. But big companies have to start somewhere. And the rate of turnover among the Fortune Global 500 seems to increase every year. And so at Fortune, we also pay close attention to the world of venture capital and to the new companies who are driving innovation, transforming the global business landscape, and disrupting established businesses on their way to becoming the Fortune 500 companies of tomorrow. So in that sense, new companies are upstarts as well as startups. They're very disruptive. They really change things fast, and more of them are emerging right here in Asia. And so that's why I am delighted to share a few thoughts today about the startup ecosystems in two of Asia's most important cities, Hong Kong and Singapore. You know, Hong Kong and Singapore are often described as rivals. Hong Kongers and Singaporeans love to debate who has the higher cost of living, the bigger freight terminal, a busier airport, better food, or attracts the regional headquarters of more multinational corporations. But for startups, the most important features of these two cities are the things that they have in common. And let me just list a few. Both are hub cities that started as trade entrepots and emerged as key centers for cargo, transportation, and finance. Both offer great infrastructure, reliable high-speed telecommunications network, and an ample supply of well-educated and multilingual workers. Both can boast of world-class universities engaged in cutting-edge research in science and technology. Both have low tax regimes and business-friendly legal systems that afford substantial protections for intellectual property. And both governments have governments that are broadly supportive of free enterprise, but also recognize the need to provide special help to encourage the creation and growth of early stage ventures. So those are solid fundamentals, and they're things that few other global cities can match. But Hong Kong and Singapore's many advantages are offset by a common and overwhelming limitation. That is the lack of scale. Neither city on its own offers a market large enough for new ventures to achieve unicorn status. And so, a final, and I would argue, defining feature shared by both Hong Kong and Singapore is that their need to function as gateways to the large and fast-growing markets that they adjoin. And I hope we can delve into that, the implications of that a little bit more in our discussions today. But before we do, it's worth asking, what is a startup ecosystem anyway? And how does one evaluate whether an ecosystem is doing its job? Well, Startup Commons, which some of you may know, it's a venture research group, offers this definition. A startup ecosystem is formed by people, startups in their various stages and various types of organizations, in a location, physical and or virtual, interacting as a system to create new startup companies. So that's a lot to chew on, a rather complicated definition, but I think the basic idea is that to launch and scale successful new ventures, it takes a village. Not just entrepreneurs and investors, but also mentors, advisors, incubators, accelerators, teachers and students, leaders from government and established businesses, folks to host and organize events just like this one, and maybe even a journalist or two. I'm especially intrigued by this fuzzy notion of location, that an ecosystem can be either physical and or virtual. Now think about that for a minute. If there's one thing that we have all learned in this pandemic, it's that we don't have to be in the same room or even in the same city to do insanely great things. A week ago, I led a Fortune virtual conversation about the startup scene in Southeast Asia, and one of our speakers was Moses Low. He's the CEO of a fast-growing Indonesian fintech company called Sendit. And Moses joined our conversation via Zoom from the home of his in-laws in California. He'd been hunkered down there with his wife and his children for more than 3 months, and he described for us how, as travel ground to a halt around the world, Sendit had grown by recruiting coders from everywhere, not just in Indonesia and the Philippines, which are his two main markets, but in India, in Israel, in the Czech Republic, wherever he could find great talent. To me, Sendit's experience underscores the point that in our increasingly digitized world, ecosystems are wherever you can find support, and they're less and less about being in a physical place. Even so, in recent years, ranking startup ecosystems by city, by country, has become something of a cottage industry. And a lot of you will be familiar with these rankings. Alas, Fortune doesn't do a ranking of startup ecosystems, but I can say a little bit about two of the better-known ranking entities who do. There is Startup Genomes, Global Startup Ecosystem Rankings, and Startup Blinks, Global Startup Ecosystem Index. Kind of hard to get your tongue around those, but Hong Kong and Singapore, I'm happy to report, do very well in both of these rankings. In Startup Genomes 2020 Ecosystem Ranking, Singapore placed number 17. That was a drop from 14 the previous year, while Hong Kong came in at number 29. Startup Blink ranks both countries and cities as startup ecosystems. In its 2021 ecosystem report released just a few months ago, Startup Blink ranks Singapore 10 among countries, a gain of 6 places over its ranking in 2020. China, including Hong Kong, ranked 7th, a gain of 7 places. Among cities, Singapore's startup ecosystem ranked 25th, while Hong Kong was ranked 37th. In its most recent report, Startup Blink praised Singapore as a model for innovation, an example of a relatively small country massively overperforming and creating regional impact as an open and powerful Asian hub. The report also highlights Singapore's many public sector policies that are beneficial to startups and hailed contributions of organizations like Enterprise Singapore in creating accelerator programs to help early stage startups gain access to funding. Hong Kong doesn't normally get as much attention as Singapore in either the Startup Genome or the Startup Blink reports, but I would caution against reading too much into that. On both lists, the difference between Singapore and Hong Kong pale in significance between the differences between Singapore and Hong Kong on the one hand and the rankings leaders on the other. So for example, on both lists, the two top cities last year and this year were San Francisco and New York City. Startup Blink analysts describe San Francisco, which includes the entire Bay Area, as the supernova of startup ecosystems, with a score that is 3 times higher than the second place ranked city, which is New York, and 5 times higher than the score of the third place city, Beijing, more than 20 times higher than either Singapore or Hong Kong. It's worth noting that Asian startup systems, notably those in Beijing, Shanghai, Shenzhen, Bangalore, and Mumbai, are rising rapidly on the Startup Blink rankings. At the expense of Western cities like Boston or Chicago, London or Berlin, there's also a significant difference in the two cities' relative significance in the larger markets that they serve. Startup Blink ranks Hong Kong startup ecosystem 4th among the 8 Chinese cities to make this year's top 100 list. By contrast, Singapore was the clear number 1 in Southeast Asia, leading Jakarta, Bangkok, Kuala Lumpur, and Manila. Of course, there are other ways to measure the vibrance of startup ecosystems, the number of startups, how many people they employ, how many funds are invested, and what types of companies. The data can vary a lot depending on different definitions. We've heard some of the numbers for Hong Kong here in the earlier presentations. There's also endless debate about how many unicorns the cities can claim. We heard a couple of different estimates here this morning for Hong Kong. There are some different lists that I've seen. By my count, there are at least a good 7 or 8 that Hong Kong can claim, including some of the ones that have been mentioned here, Klook and GoGoVan, Lalamove, WeLab, and SenseTime. You know, most of these, with the exception of SenseTime, which was founded by a mainland student at the University of Hong Kong and has attracted multi-billion dollar investments from both SoftBank and Alibaba, Hong Kong's unicorns are not especially well-known globally. Most, if not all, count China's mainland as their core market. The unicorns that are frequently credited to Singapore have a slightly higher profile. They include C, the video game and e-commerce platform, formerly known as Garena, because it's currently Southeast Asia's most valuable company. Also Grab, which was launched as a ride-hailing venture in Kuala Lumpur. It's now reinvented itself as a super app and headquartered in Singapore. There's Lazada, an online company, commerce company, PetSnap, Trax, a retail analytics company, and Razer, a Hong Kong-listed consumer electronics company with headquarters in Singapore and Irvine, California. So reasonable people can disagree about these lists. You know, some of the companies that are on the Singapore list, for example, might not actually be described as unicorns or even Singaporean. Grab was founded by Malaysians, Lazada was founded by a German, and is now owned by Alibaba Group. Trax was founded by Israelis, and does most of its R&D in Tel Aviv and serves consumers in 45 markets around the world, while C and Razor are publicly traded, so technically they've graduated from unicorn status, while Grab is going public via a New York-listed special purpose company very soon, with which it recently merged. So I should say, just here in conclusion, that there are significant differences between these two-city strategies for nurturing the next generation of unicorns. I think government officials and investors in both cities would acknowledge that. Hong Kong has long recognized that one of the biggest obstacles faced by early-stage ventures here is the high cost of renting office space. And to help address that problem, we have wonderful facilities like this one and Cyberport. Today, Cyberport serves about 1,300 startups and functions as an accelerator and as an investor, much as this center does. Hong Kong is also looking to take advantage of its position as in the greater development, Bay Area development plan conceived by Beijing, which I'm sure we can talk a little bit more about this afternoon. That can create new opportunities for startups to work with mainland partners. And InvestHK, the government agency that is in charge of attracting and retaining foreign investment in the city, has supported startups very significantly by building the Start Me Up HK Festival, which takes place every year, and is now one of the world's largest tech conferences. Singapore, by and large, is usually described as having a much more activist approach than Hong Kong when it comes to fostering startup development. Where Hong Kong has traditionally preferred to leave funding of new companies to the private sector, Singapore has embraced an industrial policy approach that uses public funding directly to support startups in specific sectors with specific technologies. A recent case study by the World Bank concluded that over the past several decades, Singapore has made an increasingly strategic push to grow its startup ecosystem. Numerous policies and committees and agencies, along with substantial government funding, have been deployed to support the country's startups. I look forward to learning more about the pros and cons of those different approaches in discussion today. But before I conclude, I want to return to this question of the opportunities and the challenges that both ecosystems face functioning as gateways to larger adjoining markets. China, of course, in Hong Kong's case, China and Southeast Asia and Singapore's case are very different markets in ways that have quite profound implications for entrepreneurs, investors, and policymakers. China is the world's most populous nation, and it will soon be its largest economy. It remains a huge opportunity for startups. Innovative technologies and businesses that work in one Chinese city can very quickly be scaled to hundreds of millions of users. But China's startup scene is well developed by now, and the mainland market is dominated by a handful of enormously powerful tech giants. It has many innovation startup ecosystems of its own. And it's increasingly obvious that tech ventures whose main market is China will face fierce political headwinds in Western markets, notably the United States, as well as increasingly intense scrutiny from Beijing. Southeast Asia, by contrast, it's home to 700 million consumers. A recent study by Google and Temasek estimates the region's digital market will grow to 300 billion by 2025. That's US dollars. But Southeast Asia, too, is dominated by giant super apps who are slugging it out for victory in a region that is divided by different regulators, different languages, cultures, different levels of economic development, all conditions that complicate efforts to scale quickly. For two decades, Fortune has tried to help our readers make sense of the two most powerful forces in modern business. One is digitization, and the other is globalization. Over the past 3 years, I would argue, we have seen a very distinct shift in both of those trends. Digitization has been thrown into high gear. It's been especially accelerated by the pandemic. That's been a tonic to many startups around the region and the world. Globalization, on the other hand, is stumbling. And in many ways, it has moved in reverse. I'll just leave you with this question. Those shifts have very profound implications for people starting new ventures and trying to scale them. If, as some analysts fear, the world is dividing into two hyper-digitized but rival technoblocks, what will that mean for tomorrow's unicorns and the villages that support them? Thank you very much.